Okay, so we were at this stage in the last lecture. We came to the slide where we discussed that this machine learning is the field of study that gives the computer the ability to learn without being explicitly programmed. And I gave you the example of face recognition. I told you that the way we can code for a prime number or a Armstrong number, we cannot do the coding for face recognition because no one's face is exactly same unless they are twins. But the faces are not same, and we cannot code that, yes, if this value comes, then it is face, and this value comes, then this is not face. And there is a lot of complexity also. Let's say that you want to make a face recognition system for your university. We know that there are more than 8,000 students in Thapar, only in bachelor degree itself. And including everyone, all the faculty members, there might be 10 or 11,000 people in the Thapar University. So if you want to develop a face recognition system, you cannot write the explicit program, or we can say that you cannot directly code into your program that, yes, this is how we will do the analysis, that this is the person, this is maybe row number one, row number two, like that. But in the end, we all know that machine learning makes our job easy. And why it makes our job easy, I will show you in the next slide. So there are multiple definitions also. The official one is this one, but before that, I want to give you one example. So in 1950s, this Mr. Arthur, who gave this definition, he played this game called checkers. And checkers meant that, if you look into the video on YouTube about this game, you will understand that what you have to do is you have to diagonally move. If you are having the black checker or the white checker, you have to move diagonally only. And then if you jump the opponent, then that opponent will be giving you your checker. It will give you his checker to you. And the more you collect, the sooner you win. So this is how it is generally played. And there are multiple rules. I will share one video also. There is this video link in the end of the slide also. You can watch it later on. But the basic thing is that over time, this person, Mr. Arthur, got to know that which place is good on the board and which one is a bad position. So winning and losing positions were understood by him by experimenting, by playing again and again. So in 1998, Tom Mitchell also gave one definition, but it is depending upon this, what we say, this well-posed learning problem. This term is very important, and actually this is the first keyword in your syllabus. If you look into the syllabus, you will see that well-posed learning problem is the first keyword in your syllabus, which you need to understand how it works. So do you have any idea that what is it? It is written actually at the bottom. You can see the definition also. The basic thing is, now whenever you want to do some task, you have to perform, but the performance can only be improved by playing it again and again, and that playing again and again, that if you're playing that game again and again, it is called experience. So there are these three things: task, performance, and experience. If these three things are there, then you will be able to understand that, yes, this is how a machine learning should work. If one of the components is missing, that that problem cannot be solved by machine learning. So you have to understand the basic definition. If there is a task and you want to perform, you have to get some experience according to machine learning. So this is the basic definition that he gave. Computer program is said to learn from experience E with respect to some task P and some performance measure P. And as soon as the performance, and if the performance on T as measured by P improved by experience E. So in short, they are just saying that the performance on task P will improve with experience E. And this is the basic definition. You just have to understand that. And I hope that you understand this by example. I gave the example here itself that over time, when the player is playing it again and again, with experience, they will know that which one is a good position or which one is a bad position. Now, understanding this PEP, there are multiple examples that I will be discussing now. But for checkers play example, we can say that the task is to play the checker, play the game. Experience is that having played tens of thousands of games, obviously you cannot play 10,000 games unless you are playing it since childhood. I mean, 10,000 times you don't play any game, right? Unless you are a professional person. And performance measure P means probability to win the game against a new component. So the probability of winning is called P here. So I hope the example is clear. And similarly, if you want to, I mean, discuss the multiple problems, let's say I want to discuss P, E, and P for multiple things. Let's say stock price prediction. So for the stock's price prediction, the experience is that tens of thousands of examples are there from the previous years. I will give you one example. I hope that you know Bombay Stock Exchange, BSE, started in 1980, right? And the index is called Sensex. And it is kind of average of top 30 companies of India, the value that they hold. So that is the value of Sensex. And in 1980, it was, I think, maybe 200, 300, maybe 2000 around 1981 or 2. And it had touched maybe 4,000 by 1990. But today, the value of Sensex is maybe 52,000, I guess. So one stock of Sensex is having the value of 52,000 rupees approximately today. So that there are lots of examples. Why? Because 1982 till date, it is 41 years. And if you take the data, maybe you are taking monthly data or yearly data. Even yearly data has 41 years of data. And if you are taking monthly data, it will be into 12. And if you are taking daily basis data, it will be multiplied by 30. So these are the number of values that you are going to get. And based on those values, you will be able to do some prediction. So the data which we are getting in this case, it is the experience P, right? And similarly, if you want to do some house price prediction, you can say that how many rooms are there, what is the area of the house, number of floors are there, what is the crime rate around that area, maybe how many schools are around that place. So multiple factors are there to give you the housing price. If it is a corner house, I mean, there are thousands of things that we need to see while buying a house. So those are the values which are helping us to gain the experience to predict the value. Similarly, Bitcoin price prediction. Bitcoin is a 10-year-old thing, but I mean, there are not lots of data available, I mean, through which you can do the prediction, the accurate one. But yes, if you want to predict maybe short-term value, then you can do it for the stocks as well as Bitcoin in the same way. And performance P is that how much close you are, I mean, how much, let's say that you are giving a value, some prediction, how much close it is to the actual value. So that distance between the actual and the predicted value is measuring the performance, right? And it can be measured by maybe mean error, root mean square error. I mean, there are others also, mean square error, mean absolute error is also there, mean absolute error, mean square error. Mean error is, I mean, you know, the average. So there are multiple things. So this is how we take the values of T, E, and P. And according to the problem, we take these three values and get the values out of it. So this is how the basic machine learning problem works. You need to have these three things. You can do the same thing for image segmentation also. What is segmentation? Can anyone tell me? How will you define segmentation?
कोई भी जैसे टास्क हुआ उसको सेगमेंट्स में डिवाइड कर देंगे और फिर परफॉर्म करेंगे. जैसे मान लीजिए बिट्स ही ले लें, 16 बिट का डाटा है, 8 बिट का प्रोसेसर है, तो उसको बिट्स में डिवाइड कर दे शायद.
हाँ, मतलब आपने जो एग्जांपल दिया उसके हिसाब से ये है कि आप कह रहे हो लेट्स से कि कुछ डाटा है 16 बिट का, उसमें से 8 का कुछ है, 5 का कुछ है, 3 का कुछ है, तो ऐसे कुछ करके आपने बांट लिया, उसको हम सेगमेंटेशन बोल देंगे. बट आई विल गिव यू वन एग्जांपल व्हिच यू माइट रिलेट टू. लेट्स से दैट यू आर बिल्डिंग ए ट्रैफिक लाइट डिटेक्शन सिस्टम, ठीक है, एंड उसमें यू आर हैविंग दीस थ्री थिंग्स, रेड, येलो एंड ग्रीन, एंड देयर आर सम कार्स that you are, that are waiting for their turn to come on this side of the road. When the green light come, is there, the cars will move and they are going in this direction or maybe this direction. So when the car is moving, if you want to click a photograph, if you click a photograph on the road outside your home or maybe outside university, so you will see that there are multiple cars, right? And if you want to draw, if you want to draw the bounding box around that car, I mean, I'm very bad at drawing, but this is not a car, but just an example, that if it is a car, if you are drawing a bounding box around it, right? And if you are, if you're able to do the correct drawing around the car and the space, extra space is not there. So this is kind of a segmentation. The detection of a car or maybe a face, even this is segmentation. If there are, I told you that there are 9 faces in the photograph. If you're detecting a face, this is also segmentation. If you are getting this face segmented out of the original image. Okay, so if you are moving this image out of the original image, then it is a segmentation problem only. And even within a face, let's say that this is the face and these are the eyes. Okay, this is the mouth. So if you are segmenting the eyes portion, you will be required to successfully detect the eyes. You have to make those boxes around the eyes. So this is one example. It is a high level problem, but right now I can only say you that segmentation means that you are detecting something and bringing it out of the original image, the smaller portion of it. So that is called image segmentation. Breast cancer detection, you have to tell if it is a cancer or not. Okay. Yes or no problem. Cartoonify or emojify an image. So there are lots of apps that are coming these days that you want to click a photograph and you want to get the cartoon image of yourself. So these are different tasks, and the experience will be in this one, first one, tens of thousands of images with labeling of different objects. So let's say that on the road, this there is a red light also, there is this, there are cars also, there are cycle, bike, maybe people are also standing on the side of the road. So if you're able to make different boxes around each one of them, obviously you can do the color coding. By color coding, I mean, for the people, you can have the green boxes. For the cars, you can have the red boxes. For maybe cycle, you can have blue boxes. I mean, there are different things. So these are the different things, right? I mean, this is how we are required to do the segmentation. This is experience, because if you have the data set available with you, if you have maybe thousands of images in which those boxes are made, those colors of boxes are made, then you can train your model to make those kind of boxes by first detecting that what is the thing in that image, and you need to make the correct box also with the minimum extra space, and the color should also be right. So this is a multi-stage problem. For the breast cancer detection, it means that you have to do this ROI area, region of interest. So let's say that these are the lungs. Again, I would say that my drawing is not good, but within the lungs, there might be some area which is affected. So if you want to highlight this one, this section, that this is the area where the cancer is, because of this section, the cancer is there. So that coloring of that particular region is called segmentation. Okay, this is also kind of a detection problem, and you can do a classification also and the segmentation also. There are multiple things you can do on a single thing. I mean, if you are just coloring it to highlight it, it means that it is segmentation, but you are also telling that, yes, this is cancer because there is this red dot inside this lung, then it is classification problem. In the same way, you can do some emojification using the different moods. There are approximately 7 emotions of a human being. Neutral face, happy, sad, surprise, and like this, there are others also. Total 7 standard emotions are there for a human. And performance is that whether or not the image is properly segmented. If you are able to correctly segment that part of the image, or classified, measured in the terms of precision recall. So you will be learning about these terms in the coming lectures, maybe next week. But this week, these two lectures, my only target is to give this introduction, and we also want to discuss the all the different kinds of machine learning machine learning problems, supervised learning, unsupervised learning. So we'll try to cover these things till Wednesday. Now, designing a learning system. Now, you want to design a learning system. And first thing is that you need to choose the training experience. The training experience is simple. It means that you need to understand that what is the thing that you want to train on, what is the target function. So I will give you one example here. Let's say that you want to predict that if it is going to rain or not, right? For rain, you want to maybe get the air quality index value, you want to get the humidity, you want to see what is the wind, if there is a wind going on, what is the season which is right now. Okay, and for on the basis of these four things, I want to predict if it is going to rain or not. So in this case, what I will do is, let's say that there are some values randomly. I'm writing 1, 2, 3, 4. Now, based on these four values, there might be a case that it is raining, and maybe because of these four values, it is not raining, right? So in this case, the training experience will be these four things, the first four things. Why? Because these four factors are independent of each other, but my rain is dependent on these four things. So the combination of these four things will decide if the rain is going to happen or not. So this is my target value or target variable. And these are my training variables. Right. So this is how the basic machine learning experiments work. You will be given a data set in which there will be multiple multiple columns in the Excel sheet, which you need to take care of. But on the right hand side, there will be a target column, based on which there will be some values. It might be 1, 200, there might be 100 classes, there might be 0 and 1, binary classification problem, maybe 1, 2, 3. So these target values will be my classes. One second, I think something happened in the network. Can you hear me? Should I continue?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I was saying that there are different columns, right? I mean, in this case, there was this AQI, humidity, wind, season, and based on those four values, you were saying that it will rain or not. So those first four columns were my training experience values, which were helping me to make the decision. And in the end, the final column is my target function, which is actually holding the values that it will be yes or no, or maybe 1, 2, 3 different things. Now, choosing a representation for the target function. I mean, it means very simple. Representation of target function means that it might be, in a binary case, it might be 0, 1, or maybe 1, 2, maybe male or female, right? But for machine learning, you have to convert these things also into numbers only. I'm giving you lots of things in these lectures. You need to remember these things when you will be solving the problems. The basic reason is that when we are writing this, male and female, so even if you train your model and you are making some equation which is fitting the data, and data is, let's say, randomly put here in X and Y, right? So obviously you are fitting a mathematical equation and you want to get the value in a mathematics way only. That's why we are going to write the value of 0 and 1. Why? Because in the end, the equation will be giving some output, and I want that output into number form rather than ABCD. So for now, we will consider that whenever we want to solve any problem, even if it is male and female problem, gender recognition, right? And the second thing can be, maybe there is this Iris dataset. Iris dataset is very famous. You can search on Google later on. But Iris flower dataset is there. There are three types of flowers. I am unable to recall all the names, but one of the name is Citosa, Virginica, and one more is there. So there are three names of the different class. So in that case also you will be giving them numbers of 1, 2, 3 rather than you don't want to get the prediction in name form, right? Because mathematically you want to get the answers. Similarly, choosing a function approximation algorithm. Now, function approximation algorithm means that what is the equation, what is the kind of equation you are going to use to solve your problem. It might be a x squared equation, it might be x cubed equation, it may be x to the power 5, x to the power 10. So it depends that what kind of a function you are using to solve that problem to get the best answer out of it. So these are the different 5 things that you need. The final design is the obviously final design. Nothing to explain here. Final design means that what is the final output? What is the final decisions that you have taken and the final structure out of the system is there. Now, I will give you again some examples. Whether a training experience provides a direct or indirect feedback. Now, it depends that what kind of a feedback you are giving using the training experience. Training experiences, I will give you again this example. Experience was that we were having tens of thousands of images. So the training data will give us training experience. Training data will give us training experience, right? So based on this data only, we will be having the experience and we have to make some decision. But we have to see that if it provides a direct or indirect feedback. Let's see what it means. Direct training examples for playing checkers may include individual checker board states and the correct move for each. So obviously we saw that there were these in this checkers game, 12 black checkers were there and 12 white checkers were there. So it might be the case that it has some position and based on this position, you are making some decision that when, if you are in the third row, where to move, and if you're in the fourth row, where to move based on your neighbors. So that's your training experience. That's your data that you have. So based on those equations, that is your direct training example. Indirect is that what is the sequence and the final outcome of the game. So indirect can be that if you move, you can move multiple steps. The combination of multiple steps is indirect. You are not directly knowing that which case you will be following. So that's indirect training. Degree to which the learner controls. So you also take care of the we need to take care of the degree also. Learner may be provided training experience by random process or learner collects the training example. It means that how much control you have on your data, right? Training examples are there. There is this data, but how much control do you have on the sequence of examples? In this case, we are writing the sentences based on our checker problem only. So let's say that you are moving like this. Diagonally, you have to move every time. One way to move like this, the other way to move like this, right? And the third way can be you are moving ahead and then coming back and then coming here back. You can move back also, right? You have to move diagonally. So if I remember correctly, you can move back also in this game. So now there are multiple sequences, right? Let's number these positions. Let's say that this is level 2, this is level 1, this is level 3, 2, 3, 4, again 2, 3, 4. But maybe you're moving 2 right on this, maybe this can be 5. So there are these sequences now, 1, 2, 3, 2, 3, 4, 2, 3, 5. Right? So these are the different sequences. Now based on this, you may or may not have a control. You might not have that kind of answer in your data already, but this is how the things have to work. Now, how does the training example represent the distribution of examples over the final system? So the basic thing is that you can only handle a problem in a good way if you have that kind of example in your system. I will give you an example now. I will relate this to a real world problem. Let's say that obviously, everyone of us don't know how to speak Chinese, right? So that is not feeded into our system. So that is not in our control. If someone speaks Chinese in front of us, unless we have a translator or Google Translate app, we cannot understand what is there, right? So that's what it means by this, these two sentences. It means that whatever you have to use that only. If you are not having something in your data, you may not be able to understand that. I mean, machine learning is not knowing anything prior to your training model. So whatever you will have to use the data only, whatever data you have, right? And that target function is that how to get the output. So let's see how it works. Reduce the learning task to a problem of discovering the ideal target function. So you have to understand that what is the actual output that we need. There might be two classes, there might be three or five, maybe 100. So it depends on what are the things that you need to get out of the problem. I will give you again one example to understand this slide more clearly. Let's say that you have this data set. In this data set, you have maybe 9 people. And so there can be one problem in which you want to predict that 1 to 9, what is the name of the person, right? The second problem can be how many of these are male and female. Okay. Third problem is that what is the age group, or maybe what is the exact age of that same person or of different people in the group. So it might be different ages, maybe 15, maybe 20, maybe 25. So ages have different target value. Male and female gender has different target value. If you want to get the person name, it has different values. I mean, in this case, there are 9 classes. In this case, there are 2 classes. In this case, there are, let's say, 3 classes. So it depends that how are you targeting your problem. So that's how you need to first decide that what is the target function. And then, for instance, for a checker program, so this is the equation. V state is defined by B to R. So let's say that V maps any legal board state from set B to some real value. I mean, it is understandable that at any place on the board, it depends that what kind of value you are getting, and that's the value stored in V. And the target function V is intended to assign better score to better board states. Now, choosing representation of target function, we must choose a representation that the learning system will use to describe the target function. I know this is quite theoretical things, but I need to explain you these things. These are part of your syllabus, and you need to understand the basics. So these are very basic things. That's why you have to understand. But I'm trying to explain you by giving examples so that you can remember these more easily. Now, we may allow the program to represent the V value as a large table with a distinct entry specifying the value for each distinct board state. Now, the thing is that it might be a case that you are solving the equation with this x to the power 6 value, till x to the power 6 value. It means that you have 6x values, right? I mean, x1, 2, x6. There are 6 variables. W0, W1, W2, these are the weights. So weights are different things. I mean, you will be again coming to this when we will be coming to deep learning in neural networks. So in neural networks, you will be understanding this weight term more correctly in the detailed manner. But right now you can only, remember this thing that W values are the different variables that we have, the constant values that we have. And those values will be changing, these W0 to W6. These are the 7 values that will be updating itself depending upon what is the V value. So if you want to get the V value as 1, there might be a case that X1, X2, X3 has a particular combination along with these W0 to W6. These 7 values have to be in such a way that the final output is 1. And it can be 2 for some other combination of W0 to W6. So these are the different examples we need to look into. So in order to learn the target approximation function, we need the methods for the following: estimating the training values. Each training example in an ordered pair of B and V. So it means that based on this B value, the board state, we will be getting this V train value, which will be helping us later on as a training value. We will be using them into the training process of the machine learning model. But this is a pairing that has been done. So these training values need to estimate in case the indirect training experience is there. Okay, so indirect training experience was, what was it? indirect was that you have to predict the sequence, right? You don't have the values of a sequence. You have only one particular board state. So after some steps, there will be some sequence, and that sequence is got through this B comma VB. So whatever VB will be there, depending upon the next step, that will be become B, and the next value will be, get through the sequence. Let's say that you are at this point. At this point, it is B comma V, and this V will be used as the initial point again, and then the next point will be get using the same formula. So adjusting the weights, it means that depending upon the W values, W naught to W6 in that case, the values will be, the final answer will be selected. It might be 1, it might be 2, 3, but these will play a very important role. So whatever the sequence of the values they have, depending upon that only you will get all the answers. And the learning algorithm must choose the weight wi to best fit this. So you have to get the best value. One common approach is to define the best hypothesis. So one approach is that you can have a particular set of values that you think that yes, ke mujhe to yahi use karna hai. So let's say that for w0 to w6 we have these 0, 1, 2, 3 up to 6. So this is the default value that I am going to use for my model. But it can be changed over time, maybe if I want to use some other technique. But this is a hypothesis that I want to use this combination. And this combination will be helping us to get the square error, and hypothesis will be used to calculate the V value. So in whichever way you have the minimum square error, that will be the hypothesis selected. So several algorithms exist. There are multiple algorithms also. Leishman square error. Leishman square training rule is there, and for each observation training example it adjusts the value of weight. So we will see that how this LMS works. Leishman square updation rule, this is how the values gets updated using the current value of the using the current value of the weights to estimate this, the value is updated like this. So whenever this hat comes, hat means that the prediction is there. So this is the predicted value, generally this is followed. I hope I'm right. Yeah, it looks right. So in this case, wi is my final value, but for that I need to add these values into my current wi. So weight I will be only updated by using these values. In this case, this alpha is the learning rate. It is learning rate. So this is my current value, this is my prediction value, actual minus predicted, you can say actual minus predicted value in this bracket. So it means that the error is being calculated into x of I. So whichever x of I is there, depending upon x0, x2, x3, up to x6. So this is how the value of wi is calculated in case the values are being updated. So I know there is a bit of mathematics. I will share the slides also with you people. You can revise it. The final design is that new problem. So for the experiment generator, there is this hypothesis that we use, and using this hypothesis, there are performances also being calculated, and for after performances, there are critics also. This slide is not much important to you, but for understanding that how it works in a loop, why there is a loop, it is because it is a continuous process. It is not that you are doing it only once. It is a continuous process. The performance is made every time whenever you are doing some changes. Let's say that for a particular hypothesis, you get some output. But after that, you want to improve that same answer. Then you will have this again different hypothesis. For different hypothesis, you need to calculate the performance again and again. There will be some set of training examples. There will be some different answers also. So there is this thing written here, solution trees. It means game history. So in this case, we are looking into different answers, that what is the output that is coming. And depending upon that, we take the best decision to make the things look good. So there are different issues in machine learning. Now I will be discussing some issues and then applications. So let's see. There are different issues. Why? One issue is that what learning algorithm exists for learning general target function from specific training example. So which algorithm is existing already, you need to understand that. I mean, the field of machine learning is concerned with answering the questions. Now, whenever you have a machine learning problem in front of you, there are thousands of algorithms available to you. Even when you are given a task, let's say that I will be giving you a Kaggle problem to solve. Let's say I give you 1 week to solve one Kaggle problem. Now, there are thousands of solutions available online. Now, which one is best? And how will you know that this is the best approach that we need to follow? Because prediction can be done by any algorithm. You can use any mathematical algorithm, any machine learning algorithm to do some prediction. It might perform good, it might perform bad. But which one is the best one? How to decide that? That's the problem, right? Now, in what settings will the particular algorithm converge? Converge means that, let's say that you are training something, you are training a model, and your accuracy is increasing or decreasing, and after some time, it goes to constant value. So now, when it is not changing, this means that the convergence has taken place. So this is convergence when the values are constant. Okay. It means that now, in what settings will particular algorithm converge to desired function given sufficient data? So now it is also a problem that how will this convergence happen and how to take the decision. So that you need to take care of. Now, which algorithm performs the best? There are multiple algorithms. Which one is performing the best? How much training data? How much examples are there? Let's say now you want to train, I will again give the example. You want to train a face recognition system, let's say 10,000 people, right, of Thapar. Now, how will you decide that how many photographs of each person do you need? Do you need only one photograph per person, maybe 5, maybe 10, maybe 100? So how to take that decision that how will my model perform if this much of images are given to that the model? So that is a good thing to go into. I mean, you need to do some experimentation initially. When you don't have the expertise, you need to do the experimentation maybe with 5 images, maybe then 10 images. So different models need different numbers of images, from converging to the best number. Now, when and how can the prior knowledge help? Now, I have a face recognition, experience. I have worked on face recognition. But let's say that I am given a medical data set and I want to do the prediction of maybe COVID or not, right? So I don't have knowledge of medical background, that how this COVID works and how will my model perform well if this happens and if this, I mean, there are different levels of understanding of a particular problem for everyone. So how does that knowledge helps us? So that is one of the things. It is very subjective thing. Everyone is different. Everyone have a different knowledge. What is the best way to reduce the learning task to one or more function approximation functions? And in other words, what specific functions should the system attempt to learn? Now, approximation function ki baat ho rahi hai. Function approximation means that in a way you need to get the best answer and at a constant rate. Now, every model's major objective is that you need to perform best. You need to maybe get to 90% accuracy, maybe 80% accuracy, maybe 95%, depending on what kind of a problem it is. Now, that is one of the tasks, that how to reduce the learning task to one or more. Now, how will you take decision that, yes, this is the exact function approximation algorithm that I will be using rather than the other one? So that decision making is one of the issues. Can the process of learning target function be automated? Now, can we automate this? Let's say that there are tens of models that you will be studying in this course. Now, can you automate it? Depending upon the problem given to you, can you make an automatic machine learning algorithm problem solver that, yes, for this kind of a problem, I will be using this model. For this problem, I will be using this model. For credit card fraud, maybe for face recognition, for IPL prediction, for World Cup prediction. There are different things, right? So for different problems, different algorithms can help. Now, how can the learner automatically alter its representation to improve its ability to represent and learn the target function? Now, it is depending upon the learner also, the model which is learning, that it will be able to convert those values while doing some iterations. Now, machine learning is a iterative thing. we were talking about these values W0, W1, W2, up to W6. These were the seven different weights, and these seven different weights were being updated every time. Let's say that there are 100 iterations that are going on, and after 80 iterations, you get the best accuracy. Until 100 iterations, you are getting the same accuracy, let's say 95%, from 80 to 100, right? So iterations are there. Different iterations were there initially. After 10 iterations, the accuracy was maybe 10%. After 20, it was 20. After 80, it was 95%, right? Here, 95% was reached. Now, every time the number of iterations were improving, these values were different every time. Iteration 1, W0 to W6 has different values. Similarly, iteration number 2, different values. So those are the different updations that are being done. Now, there are different applications also. In terms of applications, there are automatic driving, the handwriting recognition, NLP problem, computer vision. Computer vision is a very, very vast field. Similarly, automatic driving is also very vast. You need to go through different problems to understand that what are the different applications that can be solved by machine learning. Self-customization problem, the recommendation engines, right? Data mining, web-click data, medical records, biology, engineering, and this understanding the human behavior. So I will tell you one website to explore. It is called Papers with Code. You can explore this one today, paperswithcode.com. On this website, go to different sections and explore that what are the different areas in computer vision or maybe NLP, what are the kind of different algorithms that people are working on, what kind of problems they are solving. I will show you that in a minute. So the slide is over. This is the final link. I will share the slide on the website today. You can click on this link and you will reach this website. I will share the screen 1 second. Yeah, so you will reach this video, and it is a 2-minute video. You can watch it and understand that how this checker works. And I wanted to discuss this website with you, paperswithcode.com. So on this website, you will find browse state of the art button at the top. Click on it. You will reach browse state of the art, and there are different problems. Now, computer vision, see all 1107 tasks, right? I hope that you can see my this screen. So there are 1107 tasks for computer vision. For NLP also, see all 461 tasks. For medical, 220 tasks. There are multiple problems that search and browse and understand. So segmentation problem is there. Image classification problem is there. Detection, domain adaptation. So go see these kind of problems and you will understand that how and why this machine learning and deep learning are flourishing in this present time. Okay, that's all from my side for today. We will meet in the tomorrow's lecture. I will be sharing the video as well as the slide of this lecture with you people on the website, and you can go through that. And we will meet in the tomorrow's lecture. We will be understanding that what are the different types of machine learning algorithms available to us. Thank you.